Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good to be back with you and worship with you this morning. First of all, this morning I wish to just, bottom of my heart, thank Lynn and Betsy for their time and greeting our church. It's gorgeous, and thank you for that. Appreciate it. Appreciate everybody who last Sunday worked to present the refreshments and everything at the service, both morning and evening. Thank you for all you did. A couple of things to announce to you. First of all, our session will be meeting again Monday night. We met last week. Unfortunately, I was under the weather. And so we will finish up our business tomorrow evening. It will be a Zoom meeting. And also then on Tuesday morning, Congregational Life will meet in my office. And so just take note of those things. I have an update on Kathy Rubenstein. I contacted Jenna last evening, and Kathy is under hospice care. She is resting comfortably. She is not, she has a very difficult time, not difficult time. Her ability to communicate is significantly impaired through this. She is at peace. She shared with me that she is ready. She has endured far more than any of us could ever imagine, and she is tired. And so they have made that decision for hospice to come in, and it is comforting to know that she is comfortable. It is difficult to know that her time with us is short. Remarkable lady. I also wish to announce to you that next Sunday morning, excuse me, following the potluck, or our service will be a potluck. We're looking forward to this one. We're just going to keep it very simple. It's hot dogs and soup. Bring a dish if you want. We hope that you would, you know, more than just hot dog and soup, but salad, dessert, whatever. And we just want to spend some time together in the fellowship hall. Also, I just wanted to let you know there's a story behind this particular devotional book that is over on the table. It was about 2 years ago. I think we were right in the midst of COVID, if I'm not mistaken. And we were doing, a Congregational Life meeting, and Jana began reading from a devotion, and it was by Paul David Tripp, and I had never really heard of him. I had heard of him, but I had never really followed him. Anyway, the devotion that she read that day really captured my heart, and so I went and I bought the devotion for myself, and then I bought several bundles of them, gave them to friends. It became Julie's primary devotional. It's a wonderful, wonderful devotional. Paul has a real gift for connecting everything back to Christ. The devotional books that are over on the table. He's just a wonderful writer, and I was looking. It actually is a devotional book for the season of Advent. It is not year specific, so it can be used in the future. I think they make even wonderful gifts for others because of the way that he has it formatted. But just to give you a sense for today, here's a little brief snippet from it. The angels sang a glory song, not only because the events about which they sang were glorious, but because the one who came was, is, and will ever be the sum and definition of glory. Angels sang of glory because glory had come to earth to rescue us from the inglory of sin and to unleash the forgiving and transforming glory of his grace on all who would believe. But he said, there's something else that I want you to think about, and this is just a few snippets. The angels, as they sang their glory song that night, began the singing with a glory song that would never end. God's people have penned and sung glory songs about Jesus ever since. And whenever and wherever they gather, they sing together of the birth, the life, the death, the resurrection, the promises, the presence, the power, and the grace of Christ. Around the world, hearts lift and hope comes rushing in as melodies carry the precious truths of God's most wonderful gift to us, the gift of His Son. And then he always tags his devotionals to additional scripture readings. So I recommend it highly to you. I think it'll be of benefit to you as you have this season of Lent to further develop your spiritual relationship with Christ. Is there anything else that needs to be announced this morning? Would you join then with me in our call to worship?
May the grace
of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Lord has done wonderful things for us, offering us this season to celebrate our deliverance from darkness and renew our longing for wholeness that is to come. The Lord has done wonderful things for us, offering us this season to reflect on the past and to look forward in faith to the future.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord,
my soul. The Lord has done wonderful things for us, offering us this season to once again reflect on the power of hope, peace, joy, and love that is ours in Christ Jesus. The Advent journey has begun. We've started getting ready for Christmas. The light of one candle has guided us the little way that we've traveled. But we have a need for something new, because this one light is not enough to show us the way. We need more light for the journey if we are to find our way to the place where beloved community becomes real and all creation can dwell together without fear. We call this destination shalom, the powerful sense that all is as it should be, and it lies deep within the ultimate destination of our Advent journey. As we light this second candle of peace, we remember that God's light shows us that things can and one day will be different. This is at the heart of our longing. When things are at their most broken, God can and will bring peace on earth. We acknowledge that the Prince of Peace will make all things new, and we join in the longing of all who have gone before us as strangers and aliens on the earth, looking for a city whose maker and giver is God. Let us pray. God of the past and God of the future, be the God who is present with us today, and through your Spirit, nurture within us a deep longing for peace in our world and in our own lives as we worship you. Help us to see your faithful hand that has guided us to this moment, and help us to trust your faithfulness to bring all your promises to fulfillment. Amen.
Thank you. morning.
Good morning.
Today, we are worshiping from the Psalm 72. Give the king your judgments, O God, and your righteousness to the king's son.
May you judge your people with righteousness and your reward with justice.
May the mountains bring well-being to the people and the hills reveal justice.
May you judge the poor of the people. May you save the children of the youth and crush the oppressor.
May he descend like the rain on the mowed grass, as showers dripping on the earth.
In his days the righteous flourish, and the abundance of beasts prevail, until the moon is no more.
May he have dominion from sea to sea, and from the rivers to the ends of the earth.
May all kings bow down before him, may all nations serve him.
May he deliver the needy when he cries, the poor also, and him who has no helper.
May he have compassion on the poor and save the lives of the needy. May he redeem their life from deceit and violence, and may their blood be precious in his sight.
May his name endure forever. May his name increase as the sun. May men and women be blessed in him. By all nations, call him blessed.
Blessed be the Lord God.
Our call to confession today, filled with hope, yet recognizing our need for true peace, both with others and within our own selves. Let us confess those ways we are distanced ourselves from God. God, you have a vision of time and place where enemies become best friends, and the world is a safe place for all children. But we fail to believe that such a kingdom is available to us, for our eyes are blinded by sin. Although Christ is among us as our peace, we are a people divided against ourselves as we cling to the values of a broken world. We live with anxiety and fear. We dwell amid strife and division. We do life in denial of the peace that comes from knowing you. Lord, have mercy upon us. Heal and forgive us. Please set us free to serve you in the world as agents of your reconciling love in Jesus Christ. And restore our hearts to your perfect design. We pray all these things in the name of the risen Christ, for whom we long in the Advent season. Amen. Please take a moment for silent prayers. We confess and we rejoice, for God has accepted us for who we are and claimed us as his own children. We lift our praise to God who calls us to peace and grace. Thanks be to God, we are forgiven. Please share the peace of God with one another.
Thank you.
I don't know if it helps if you know what goes through the mind of a pastor or not, but when I stood up and I looked out and I saw Brenda this morning, I thought, God save the Queen. Your hat is so amazing. It is wonderful. So I wanted to ask you, Brenda, if you would serve as our royalty today. I don't know, does that help you to know what goes through my mind? Probably not. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for words of Scripture. Bring them into our hearts and lives today. Help us to become changed. Grant us a picture of something that is totally foreign, totally alien, totally different from life as we know it. Grant us eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts to understand the things that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Our text today is found in Romans chapter 15. Paul is writing, and he says these words. Whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accordance with Jesus, or in accord with Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised to show God's truthfulness, to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles and sing to your name. And again it is said, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples extol him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will come, even he who arises to rule the Gentiles. In him will the Gentiles hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, I want to start my message to you this morning with a question. I'm actually going to try to give you a little bit of time to think about it. It's actually a couple of questions all lumped together in one. When you envision heaven, what do you see? When you envision heaven, what do you see? Do you imagine something wonderful and splendid? And if so, why do you expect it to be wonderful and splendid? What is it that you see there that makes it wonderful or splendid? So just for a second, just think about that. I speak of heaven all the time. I think about heaven. I'm comforted knowing that my departed loved ones are in heaven. What do you envision when you think of heaven? Why is it you think that your loved ones who have departed are in a far better place? I've seen the idea of heaven being this source of immense consolation to people that when their loved one passes on, I can't tell you how many times I've heard, well, she's in heaven now, and in a far better place. All the struggles are over. He's at rest with his Savior. We talk about heaven as being this place where we imagine all kinds of things, but do we ever just really stop and say, what is it that I imagine? I want you to come up with some words that give evidence to what you envision heaven to be. There are people who see their loved ones having angel wings now and playing the harp. Does that sound like that would be interesting for ever and ever without end, just sitting there strumming on a harp? Some people say, well, heaven is going to be awesome because I'm going to be in the presence of my Savior. Are you in the presence of your Savior now? Is that something you look forward to every day? And if it's not something that you take seriously now and derive joy from now every day, what makes you think that to do that forever would somehow be wonderful? Do you see it as being proficient in all of the things in life that frustrate you? I've heard people say things like, well, Uncle Charlie's up there and he probably is on his third hole in one today. If one gets a hole in one on every shot, every day, throughout eternity, is that something special? Or does that get old? What is it you think about heaven? What do you see when you imagine heaven? I remember fairly early in my faith, I got this sense. I was in the book of Revelation, and I was imagining, and I thought, oh my goodness, I'm walking on streets of gold. So I pictured it in my mind. Jewels everywhere. Mansions, just amazing. And then I thought, is that really something to look forward to? If the street that I walk on is paved with gold, does gold have any value? Is it precious? And if everyone lives in huge mansions, are mansions anything special? Or are they just like the huts that everyone lives in a particular culture? They all just kind of blend in together. What is it that you think about when you think of heaven? For me, the number one preeminent thing that I imagine when I envision heaven, or whatever you want to call it, I don't normally use the word heaven, but I realize that most people do. I imagine it to be the reign of Christ. I imagine it to be the kingdom that has come. But when I envision it, I envision an existence without any suffering, without any pain, without any sorrow, and without any tears. So I envision it as something that is, there are qualities that are absent, that are qualities in my life now. Like there's a certain amount of pain that I live with now. There's a certain amount of suffering that I have to endure now. There's a certain amount of sorrow that I experience, that I watch others experience, that brings sorrow to me. And there are tears that are a part of my life now. And I envision a place, I envision a reign, a rule, a domain in which those things no longer appear. There's an absence of those. But there has to be a sense in which it's more than just the absence of something. For to me, when I think of the reign of Christ, I think of the full existence of harmony and love and peace and joy. You see, when I picture that, those are things that could be enjoyed forever, because there's unfolding layers of that that can be experienced and enjoyed. I have a longing in my heart for harmony. I have a longing in my heart for love, to be loved, to experience love with other people. An unfettered love, an unchecked love, an unbridled love. I have a longing for a deep place of peace, just existing within the sense of everything being right and no discord, no dissonance. I have a phenomenal longing in my heart for just a fullness of joy. I see the reign of Christ as something that is indescribable. It is something otherworldly, but it has qualities of our world because our world is an extension of heaven. We live in a physical world, but the realm of heaven, the reign of Christ, permeates around us. And so I try to see in my mind's eye, what is it about heaven that is calling me? What is it about heaven that when I lose a loved one, I can entrust them into knowing that there's something better? I can know that the season of tears and sorrows, suffering and pain is over. And that there's harmony and love and peace and joy in its fullness abounding for them. I can get excited about that. I think because we don't really think about heaven and what is to come. We talk about it in romantic terms, but we really don't know what to do with it. I can't tell you how many times over years of ministry, people have come to me and say, heaven is so awesome, I just can't wait to get there. And yet when something comes that threatens their life in the end of their existence here, they're all in a panic. And I think, are you really convinced that there's something better than right now? Or is that just a romantic term? Advent asked us to view the idea of heaven as the fullness or the completion of hope, peace, joy, and love. What Advent asked us to do is take the very same things that we are going to celebrate on Christmas Eve in the birth of Christ. The fact that Christ brings peace, Christ brings hope, Christ brings joy, Christ brings love. All of the great Christmas hymns have those themes around which the lyrics are written. Because with the coming of the Christ child in Bethlehem, the world, the weary world, rejoices. Peace on earth and goodwill to man. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Hope has arrived. Advent asks us to take the Christ child and all the things that are associated with his coming and to imagine them fully and completely ruling and reigning over all of life. While Jesus brought that to the earth and those elements exist, they are opposed by other elements in our world. They are opposed by part of us that resists what they stand for, because we are so enmeshed in a world that falls short of that. But when we see that Jesus has introduced that to our world, and there are bits and pieces that we hold on to and we celebrate from those four things, Advent calls us to look to a future when we don't have to claw and grasp and try to hold on to and convince ourselves that, yes, I have joy. Can't you tell? Yes, I'm at peace. Can I complain some more? Oh, my goodness. The love I feel in my heart is overwhelming for you. Why do you annoy me so much? Yeah, I have hope. I hope for some amazing things. But today I'm feeling a little down, a little discouraged. Advent asks us to see the same things that were in Bethlehem launched into our world by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, and take them and to imagine the fullness that what he inaugurated with his coming has now suddenly become the reality for all of heaven and all of earth. That's where Paul takes us in his writings to the Roman church. Take a couple of minutes here, just give you a little background. First of all, note that when Paul is writing to the churches at Rome, he is writing to seven churches. He identifies them. And they all exist in small or maybe large homes, but they're all house churches. So when you read the words of Paul, which in this, what we consider this great masterpiece of theology, he's writing it for small groups of people. Imagine our living room with a group of people gathered together on Sunday morning to worship. Maybe 10, maybe 20. Maybe we've moved into somebody's great room and we actually have 30 or 40 people in there, but it's small groups of people. And these churches that exist in these small churches, they have issues that they're dealing with. That's why Paul in his thing says that he encourages them to live in harmony with one another and to welcome one another, because they're struggling with that. And if you were to read the chapter prior to this, you would see what they're struggling with. From the names that he lists, we observe names that would be applicable to Romans. There are Latin names and there are Jewish names. In other words, these small groups of people have within their homes a very mixed bag of people. I find it difficult enough in my longing for hope and peace and joy and love to do life with those who are pretty much in agreement with me. It still gets difficult. But imagine trying to do life with a whole bunch of people. We've got Republicans and Democrats in there. We've got rich and poor in there. We have blacks and whites and Hispanics in there. We have people coming from different backgrounds and different cultures and traditions, all existing together, all seeking God together, all believing that who they are and what they are and what they think is the way everybody should believe and be and think. Their backgrounds create social tensions. Imagine a room of farmers together with tech billionaires, Elon Musk sitting with Ma and Pa Kettle. Imagine a room with Pentecostals and Presbyterians trying to figure out how we're going to worship. It is diversity that causes great issues. In fact, I think one of the reasons that things have gotten so complex in our world and there is so much conflict in our world is that America finally recognized that it was no longer just a primarily a white European Christian nation. And as it has opened the doors to the diversity, it brings a certain amount of threatenedness to the existing status quo. I think one of the issues is because all of a sudden we've woken up in the midst of a very diverse culture, spiritually, ethnically, racially, politically, we don't know how to live within that because we're no longer under one kind of controlling mindset. So Paul takes these groups and he divides them into the weak and into the strong. That's his categories. You can read all about it in Romans 14. The strong were primarily the Gentiles. The label being strong was attached to them because they had much more freedom in Christ than the group called the weak. The Romans had status that they derived from the state. It was a status of power. So the Roman citizens in these groups, their culture, their tradition, their basis of operation is, I am a Roman citizen. I have the rights and the privileges of Roman citizenry. I have power granted to me from my place in the state. And they held people who are not like them in disdain and contempt. Now the weak, they were primarily Jewish. Paul says that they are weak because they have limitations in their freedom of Christ due to their deference to some of the pre-existing understandings of Torah. They're concerned about what they eat. They're concerned about where the food comes from and what they eat. They're concerned about what days are observed and festivals are observed. They hold to those traditions and they're weak. As I said, these are primarily the Jewish believers gathered in these living rooms. They don't have a status of power. They have a status of privilege. And that privilege is given to them from the covenant that God made with Abraham. Well, the Roman people gathered in the room can say, we are citizens of Rome, we are entitled. The Jewish people gathered in the rooms would say, we are children of Abraham, and we have privilege because of the covenant made with our father. And while the strong held the weak in contempt, the weak held the strong in judgment because they did things outside of the tradition. So Paul declares to them in Romans 14, he says, why do you judge your brother? Referring to the weak. And why do you regard your brother with contempt? Referring to the strong. So he enters our text today with the plea. May the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the God of endurance and encouragement, may he grant you to live in harmony with one another. Harmony with one another. And it's the following line that should captivate our hearts. Welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. When I was meditating on that simple sentence this week, I was thinking about Christ welcoming us. The welcome that Jesus gives us is not the welcome we extend to not one another in the Presbyterian passing of the peace. Jesus doesn't welcome us by this. Jesus doesn't welcome us by this. Jesus doesn't welcome us by this. Jesus welcomes us with this huge embrace. He welcomes us into his life. Jesus welcomes us as friends. Jesus welcomes us as brothers and sisters in the family of God. When Jesus welcomes someone, I think of embrace. I think of a shared, joined life together. It is Jesus and Nicodemus. Hey, get to your house because I'm coming there. I'm going to eat with you. It is a welcome that goes beyond just formality. It is a welcome that receives and takes in. Paul is asking the Roman church to live with one another the way Jesus would welcome us. To live with one another in the reality of what we expect heaven to be. Perhaps I could say to you that the text calls us this morning in Advent to live life right now in light of what life is to be in its fullness at the end. To live life in hope and peace and joy and love. Because we see the ultimate fulfillment, and Jesus has been working ever since the resurrection to bring all things together in himself that he might present the kingdom fully unto God the Father. Christ is working to bring all creation into the fullness of redemption, which is the fullness of hope, peace, joy, and love. And Jesus asks us to join him in the work of making that happen. So the question that emerged in my life regarding some of the things I shared on Sunday still are at work in there. I ask myself the question. If I imagine heaven or the reign of Christ to be this place where peace exists in abundance and fullness, tears and sorrow and pain and mourning, they're all gone. That there is a harmony about life that exists that is so wonderful to imagine that I could take comfort that my loved ones are there and they are waiting for me. Then I ask myself, how can I live like that now? The question is, how do we unlearn war? How do I unlearn war? War is at the heart of the Roman issue. It's people squabbling over what can be eaten and what can't. What days to observe and what days not. Where does the food come from? Squabbling over things of insignificance. That's our nature. We squabble. We're squabbling people. We only know war. We're only trained for war. And we don't know any alternatives to war. That's how we live, and we just take it for granted. The goal is always in culture, in all nations, to somehow build bigger bombs to counter the bombs of others. History is strewn with examples, and it's still going on today, of contesting for lands and borders and battles over long-held grudges. There's something in us that always wants to retaliate when we've been done wrong in order to try to have a sense of fairness. The only way we know how for things to be fair is somehow for somebody else to feel some of the pain that I felt. As a people in our day and time, we live in hopes of justice that is a retributive justice. Somebody getting what they deserve, not a restorative justice, where everything is made right. And there can be peace from it. How do I unlearn war? How do I live where I don't have to segregate people I don't like away from me? How do I live in such a way that I don't have to isolate myself to just be with myself to have peace? And even then I'm at war. How do I live my life not wishing to humiliate someone who has humiliated me? How do I live in such a way that I don't feel like I have to intimidate in order to hold power? I don't have to brand my enemies as being evil, dangerous. How can I live my life where I don't have to demean anyone or belittle anyone or ridicule anyone or mock anyone who is different from me? How do I live life in such a way where I've unlearned war in such a way that when someone is totally different in their mindset from me, I don't feel threatened by that. I can somehow welcome them. It doesn't mean I have to change. It doesn't mean I have to believe what they believe. We only know an either or. Is there a place where I can unlearn war? And I can dwell with you, even though we are so different. It seems to me that the art of unlearning war is the art of learning how to totally forgive. Where blessing those who have hurt me and my enemies is second nature. That turning the other cheek is a way of life. That going the extra mile is something that I look forward to doing every single day. And where the idea of suffering unjustly is not a call for self-pity, but it's a validation of who I am in Christ. Sunday evening, Matt Richardson sang the song, "Let There Be Peace on Earth." The implication is, as the writer penned the lyrics, let there be peace on earth. And let it begin where? In me. Let it be in everything that I'm about. Everything that I stand for. If I long for this place where peace is part of the existence that I'm going to have in its fullness, then my life needs to come into a place where I'm living that way now and representing it to others. I am so skilled in the art of war that I even do battle within my own life with myself. If I hate myself today and badger myself today, if I somehow turn on myself and believe the worst about myself, then I have done some sort of battle, and I can feel good about that because maybe tomorrow I'll win. Why do I have to always be in a place where conflict within, conflict without dominates my world? Why can't I be in a place where forgiveness flows, blessing happens, and I can hope that my life is transformed into the fullness of what God wants it to be? So I end you with this. When we imagine a heaven that is filled with peace, with joy, and with love, what can I do to bring peace, joy, and love into my present world and live in the hope that it will come to fruition in God's hands? Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the words given to us that ponder us, ponder within us, cause us to ponder. What might things look like? And how might those things change even now? Deliver us from a sense of just walking blindly in our world, waiting for something we romantically think about, and help us to be ambassadors of that rain, ambassadors of heaven, showing bits and pieces of it throughout our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Our special music celebrates the faithfulness of God. It encourages us to have a heart of expectation.
Morning is coming, there's more to the story.
God is faithful. God will do it. Heaven is our inheritance. Would you join me in our prayers of intercession? God, grace, abundance, and joy, pour out your love on us every day. When we had no hope, you came as light in our dark time. When we were weak,
you came in power to lift us up.
When we were lost,
you showed us the way.
When we were confused,
you sent us the truth.
When we were alone,
you came for life.
Because of your faithfulness in our yesterdays, we place our tomorrows in your good hand. We look to you to bring peace to our world that is marred by bloodshed and war. Peace in a world that is marred by tribalism and nationalism, injustice and inequity. We look to you to bring resources where starvation, famine, and poverty have deprived people of life. We look to you to impart wisdom to those who lead our nation and to those who lead states, counties, and communities. We look to you to instill courage and humility to our leaders to love justice and to do mercy on behalf of those that they represent.
Because of your faithfulness, we find peace.
We look to you to revive your church with a fresh vision of your kingdom, to empower your people to faithfully love and serve others, and to renew your bride in righteousness, peace, and joy. And we look to you to heal the sick who are among us, mend the broken among us, empower the weak among us, to strengthen the weary among us, to comfort the grieving and distressed among us. We look to you to care for our loved ones, those who we raise from our hearts into your hands, especially Kathy and Harold and Bob and Connie and Sherry and April. Now, Lord, we place before you our families, our loved ones, our circle of friends. We bring their names silently to you. We entrust them to your love and to your care. In all of this, we look to you.
Because of your faithfulness, we find peace and rest in you.
Would you join me in our Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
you. May the Lord our God bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. May that which you long for in heaven be something you are committed to in your life on earth. Go in peace, for we are. Amen.